Hello and welcome to Tools in the Shed, a podcast powered by CarsGuide, and we're ready to rip into car stuff that has caught our eye this week. Welcome to 2020. I'm James. With me is Richard.
Hi.
And Matt.
Hello.
This week, we're in the Automotive Departure Lounge, casting an eye over some of the major ones that that left us, and we're also going to catch up with three of the cars that have passed through the CarsGuide garage this week. And we'll catch up with our favourite alleged father-to-be and slave to the rhythm in this week's MuskWatch. So stay with us.
Slave.
But first, we've had some feedback. And look, now, Remesis 023 says, I really hope Gazoo Racing is taking over for the United States. Please let me have this car, because we were talking about the Yaris GR. Chesto had the story on that. It does say it's the second global GR model since the Supra, so fingers crossed.
Yeah.
And as far as I'm aware, TRD, which was the umbrella for, you know, performance and what have you for Toyota in the States, is being superseded by GR.
Yeah.
Yep.
But as to whether or not the Yaris goes there, I'm not sure.
Yes, I don't know.
Unlikely, I want to say.
You reckon?
Yeah, yeah, I'm thinking it's, we're pretty bloody lucky we're getting it here.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I reckon with the US, they miss out on a lot of good cars over there.
They do, but the only thing that might get it over the line is all-wheel drive. So
yep, that's true.
They
yep.
love a snowy car over there.
Oh, don't they ever.
That's a good point. Jack2801 says, look, 12 minutes, 30 seconds for the Toyota GR Yaris talk. So he's obviously a bit peeved that he had to weave through all the other crap
to
get to what he wanted. Wow. So apologies for that, Jack.
Wow.
It is a podcast.
yeah.
There's other stuff on offer.
Chris, like the rest of the web.
Chris Paul Glace or Paul Glace says, just a small one. I think you'll find TRD made 800 Orions. And that is just egg all over Mal's face.
Oh, how many did he say?
I forget. Mal, but it wasn't 800. And it could be that Chris is well known to Mal. I have it on good authority that those two do know one another.
I think I've seen them conversing on the Facebook.
So Mal,
on Wikipedia.
Mal suggested that Chris could become our Orion TRD expert. He's our go-to.
Is it Chris Harris?
No.
It's Chris Paul Glace.
Paul Glace.
All right. Okay.
All right.
That's a niche job if ever there was one.
He'll have it covered. So that's good. We're progressively covering all these bases.
How many of them are left?
Let's see if just said Mazda 2, question mark.
What?
Now, I was trying to rack my brain from the last program of last year. Go ahead.
I think what they're saying is maybe that there could be a hot version of Mazda
2. That's 2 as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because currently Mazda 2 and Yaris are the same car in the US.
Yeah.
But we don't get that here.
Yeah. Okay.
And so we get a specific Yaris and a specific Mazda 2.
Yeah.
So maybe the next generation Mazda 2 will be a conglomerative effort with the Yaris.
I see. Yep.
That'd be good.
BPR Ben Pinnock says, sorry for the spelling mistake, I'm dyslexic. Now, that was
because
I took issue with Ben spelling Opal, the car maker, O-P-A-L, so a, you know, precious gemstone, as opposed to the car brand. So my apologies, BPR Ben Pinnock. And in fact, we're going to give you the Citroen Monopoly game that we threatened to give away at the end of last year. So
that's right. Not the Scrabble, though. Monopoly.
No. Get to comments at carsguide.com.au. Give us your address details, and we'll send that out to you.
What makes it Citroen?
It's all
pieces.
French.
Yeah, it's all
French. So you've got the Champs-Élysées. And
Des Champs-Élysées. Got everything. It's fantastic.
Champs.
Now, Rensis 023 says, I think there is an homologation requirement. 2020 R5 is moving to three-cylinder, right? And I think what he's referencing there is the World Rally Championship regulations around three-cylinder cars and all-wheel drive, 1.6 litres, etc. So the GR Yaris could well be connected to that. So that's a great pickup. Mm. And for that, Remesis 023, you get a Monopoly game as well.
you get a Monopoly game.
So do the same thing. Send us your details.
You get a Monopoly game.
Comment at carsguide.com.au and we'll send that out to you. Now, Dakook, who we've been speaking to on a regular basis, says, Happy New Year, guys.
Thanks, mate.
Finishing the Commodore topic, ZB is no doubt great car, but the resale value will be very, very zero. Now, what do you say? But the resale value will very be zero. Yaris GR is groundbreaking, so bold, I still can't believe it's Toyota. He goes on about various other things. We probably haven't got time to cover it all.
Can we get him in one day?
When he's in, when he comes to Australia. So I don't know, Richard, you'll have to get in touch with him.
Come on in.
That could be your job.
Dakook.
Yeah.
He says, keep up the good work, so that's very encouraging.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Dakook.
It's a bit squashy in the
Ian
shed,
Thomas was getting all reflective as the year came to an end. Another year of cars is gone. For me, the biggest change is the increase in EVs available in Australia. Mm-hmm. The biggest problem is charge networks across Australia is still limited. Mm. I would have to draw from my home 45 minutes to the... I'd have to drive from my home 45 minutes to the nearest charge station. Installing a home charge, depending at the speed, kilowatt hours, is expensive. Yeah. And to think, when I started work, there were no computers. The office had a telex, no mobile phones, no internet. Cars had no airbags. I remember going to a newly opened BMW showroom and thinking, wow. And BMWs are a dime a dozen now. So Ian must be a person of a certain age because I can relate to all of that.
Or he just comes from Queensland. I mean, they only got
which
all
is permanently
of that
stuck
years
in a
ago.
Certain point
yeah.
in time.
Yeah.
Rico says, how many right-hand drive markets does GM currently participate in? Australia, New Zealand, Thailand, can't think of any more.
UK.
Which is a really good point. I don't think they're there anymore. There's no Chevrolet, there's no GM in UK.
There's only Vauxhall, which is now under PSA.
Correct. Yeah, that's right.
And they've pulled out of the markets such as India.
They're
and
out of South Africa.
South Africa.
Yep.
So
if you want to go a domino theory.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly. Oh, what's that comment suggesting?
Well, the costs of making right and left-hand drive is exorbitant. Yep. So make it left-hand drive, make yourself a left-hand drive company.
Can I put something out there? EVs are going to change all that. Because you can have a centre steering wheel, I reckon, or a west steering wheel.
One that swaps across. Yeah. The wheel and pedal set connected as one item, and you just move it across one side of the car to the other.
Yeah. Autonomous cars don't even need steering wheels.
No, don't.
My God.
Where we're going, we don't need steering wheels. All right. Then
we do.
ESP Audio says Holden should retire Holden as a name, which I was grappling with.
General Motors.
I think General Motors as a name, and go with the imports native brand Chev and GMC, etc.
Yep.
I reckon a GMC Acadia would sell well. A Holden, clearly not. Those international brands have appeal. Holden just has the reek of failure.
Well, I think all those people that have put Chevy badges on their Holdens all those years, well, you know, you've got to be careful what you wish for.
They'll be vindicated.
Yeah.
Maybe
they'll be ahead of the curve.
Maybe there'll be a shortage of Holden badges to rebrand their rebranded
people will
Commodores.
Put Holden badges on their Chevys.
Man. Yeah.
Yes. Now, Stewie GB says, hi, guys. Any inkling or info as to when Hyundai are going to release their ute? I'd be a goer for a petrol hybrid and presume that Hyundai would start the ball rolling to give different options, blah, blah, blah. So that's the gist of his message.
Mm. Any ideas, Matt?
No.
No.
It's so up in the air, but we have seen some spy pictures surface of a new small-looking ute, a dual cab, apparently based on the next-generation Tucson. So,
all right. And, I mean, Hyundai, in Australia and in the Australian context, they would have liked one yesterday.
Oh, they're desperate for it.
They're really desperate for it.
Mm. So Kia's the same.
As that is Kia, that's right.
Richard just tried to catch a mint and it didn't work.
Tried to catch
for
it
our
my
listeners.
Eye.
Sorry.
Normally we're trying for random acts of kindness. That was just a random act.
My coordination is all over the shop these days.
Yeah, the workshop.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that thank you very much to everybody who gave us their feedback and their thoughts. That's much appreciated. And we're going to move on to our topic du jour, our key.
I thought somebody just walked past then.
Maybe they
in
did.
The background.
Maybe they did.
I don't know.
Security will catch him.
Yeah.
That's weird. I just,
Or Fang, our shop, the shop dog. Fang will get onto
us.
German Shepherd.
We had a story up on carsguide.com.au, it's still there, about 10 significant cars that departed the scene in 2019. Mm. So we wanted to pick our top five of that top 10 to cover off and see what we make of their departure, how significant or otherwise that might be.
Yeah.
And the first one that we agreed on was Infiniti. And it was like the long goodbye, wasn't it? It was
a goodbye
slow
that
motion.
Should never have been hello.
Hello.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. I remember 2012, I want to say, going to the relaunch of Infiniti in New Zealand. It was the M35H. And when we arrived in the hotel where we were staying, Toyota dropped the news about the pricing for the Toyota 86.
Yeah.
And everybody forgot about the
why they were there.
Yeah.
And started writing Toyota stories.
At that time, I was at the 86 launch, 29990. Yeah, everyone dropped everything. Yeah, it was like, we're going to write this quick. You know.
Yes.
But Infiniti, fell by the wayside. Right.
And this was the big relaunch. We're back. We know where we went wrong the first time around, and this time it's going to really be real.
Well, I'm old enough to have been around the first time around.
Yeah.
And I was at the launch of Infiniti when it came with the Q45, et cetera, and it was a very similar story. You know? But at that time, it was, Lexus has broken all the ice. We don't have to do that hard work. We're just going riding along that way.
Yeah.
And it didn't work out.
That's like me saying, I'm going to start up a YouTube channel and I'm going to be as popular as Doug DeMuro in a year.
Yeah.
No.
Or it's more like, I'm going to start up this thing where people can post up their videos and it's going to be just like YouTube, only people will like it more.
Yeah, because it'll be premium.
Yeah. Can I just say one word? Genesis. So are they going down an infinity path again here?
Maybe.
Look, I don't know about Genesis. I think that maybe the product is better to start with on the Genesis perspective. Yep. And they're going to have an SUV soon, so that's really important for the majority of markets. But Infiniti, I mean, they had some cars that should have appealed more than they did.
Yeah.
I think they struggled because they didn't have a dealership network set up from the beginning that was reaching where it should have reached. Mm. You know, they only had 3 dealerships at the peak of their powers,
I mean, launching any brand, irrespective of category, pretty much, you've got to invest in it.
Yeah.
You've got to really make people aware of the product. Yeah.
I think for me, there were a couple of drawbacks for Infiniti. I think one was design. It just didn't look different enough from Lexus's, you know. And then also, maybe there was only enough room for Lexus in Australia, prestige sub-brand of a regular mainstream brand.
It was the big SUV that looked like it had been punched in the face and the nose had swollen up and the eyes had kind of sunken down.
Oh, the FX.
That one.
The FX, which became the QX.
That was a challenging.
I loved the look of that car.
Of course you did.
The rounded back, the huge wheels. It was gorgeous.
Fantastic.
It was a beautiful looking car.
Well, moving on from that horrible car.
onto another.
Now, we've given a separate kind of requiem for Commodore, but we must mark that it's a nameplate that has gone into history in 2019.
Yeah.
And we've each had our big experiences with that. So there it is. Goodbye, farewell, and thank you.
You can still buy them.
You can.
I mean, in fact, they sold a few VF2s last year.
Well, that's which is
extraordinary. There's going to be ZBs still for sale in 2022 by that logic.
This is what's confusing because, as we were discussing the other day, Commodore was one of their best sellers.
Yeah.
So why did they kill one of their best sellers?
I think it's got a lot to do with this, the same sort of PSA deal and getting the right cars for the General Motors market. So with the Insignia as it's sold overseas, Vauxhall and Opel, I don't think they were going to be allowed to sell it as a Holden anymore.
Right.
That's an entirely likely scenario.
I was at an Astra launch about 3 years ago, and I remember sitting in a car with a very high-level executive from Holden. And
Front seat
we were. I was driving. He was in the passenger seat. And I said, so what's going to happen now that Opel has been sold to PSA and that's the Insignia brand, which is the platform for Commodore. Like, where's it going to leave Commodore in 5 years' time? And his answer was, 5 years is a long time. You've got nothing to worry about there.
Ooh.
But the writing was on the wall then.
Yeah.
5 years in the automotive context is not a long
time. Not a long time at all.
No, that's smoke and mirrors.
That's right.
It goes by very fast. And I think the thing with, as we've all spoken about before, moving from the Aussie-made one to the European-imported one, it was just, it wouldn't have worked no matter what happened.
Yeah. Yep.
I just think it was a mistake to do it, and they should have maybe just retired Commodore when it was a worthy time to do so.
Another high-profile name that's inspired Aussies for generations, of course, is the Kia Soul.
Oh, yes.
That's another one that caused some wrench when it departed the lineup.
Yeah.
It was really of that. Pitched at a youth market, customizable. Mm. It's a bit zany, a bit left of centre.
Mm. Yeah.
It was just a bit too expensive.
Yeah, and I mean, it's exactly that. It was never the right price point and never pitched the right way. I mean, today you look at what brands are doing around small SUVs. It was never marketed as a small SUV, but if it had been, wow, its fortunes could have been completely different.
And there's other examples of that, like there's the Cube.
Yep.
There's so many.
Toyota Ruckus.
The Ruckus, the Volkswagen Up.
Yep.
All of those are great cars. All, you know, car people love them.
Yeah.
And they're the ones which seem to have been lost.
Yeah.
The
yeah.
Up was also manual only, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Which was a bit of a handicap, as well as the price issue. Mm.
But the Kia Soul, like when it I remember driving one of the very first ones. It was one of my first cars I ever drove as a motoring journalist. Mm. And it had those speakers with the lights in them that would pulse to the beat of the music. Wow. And that was I was like, wow.
You were thinking, this is the life.
This is cool, man. This is a cool man's car.
Right, pulsing coloured speakers.
And then, you know, it was also orange with grey stickers on the outside of it. And it was just one of those things where you went, I get what they're trying to do, but they don't know what they're doing with this.
Yeah.
And I think the Soul nameplate might not be dead completely for Australia. It might return as an EV. That's the general feel of it, as as the Niro electric SUV.
Yep.
So I think Kia might refocus its energy with the Soul.
Well, I suppose it's an opportunity to learn, isn't it? You know, from that one not having hit the mark, you can only do better second time round, you'd hope. Yeah.
And but there's been a few of these small SUVs that just haven't worked. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, Ford EcoSport is one of those SUVs that designed to look really rugged and tough.
Yeah.
Just doesn't sell.
Doesn't sell, and you don't want people to park too close behind you either, because that has a tailgate which opens like
So it does. Mm. Now, Tarago. The thing that got me about Tarago's departure was it became a mainstream news story.
Yeah.
I saw it on a broadcast television news report.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was really extraordinary.
It's the Vegemite of cars, I think.
Yeah.
And it's been replaced by the Granvia, and it's not a very good replacement. The Granvia is a good van, but it's not a very good family car.
And it's more commercial grade, isn't it? Yeah. It's a professional grade kind of car.
It's comfortable, but it's a tourist shuttle, and it doesn't have a lot of room for cargo.
Yeah.
So if you're operating out of, you know, a city centre and picking up people from the airport with a little trailer on the back, it's perfect.
I reckon there's a market to do a Granvia inspired trailer design.
Yes.
So you could sell it as a package deal.
For sure.
So it's got that mad big grill on the front of it and the same sort of wheels as you get on the Granvia. I can picture
You're an ideas man.
I want to do this.
You're an ideas man.
Yeah. But I agree with you 100%. But
would you make it look like a little baby Granvia being towed behind it?
Yes.
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 That would be good.
And then you can fit all your luggage.
Yes.
But I think the thing about Tarago was that we were talking about it in the office. Mm. Everybody's got a Tarago story.
Sure.
Like, I remember we, as a family, in the mid-90s, we took one from our place in Cooma as a family group down to Echuca.
On the river.
To go on the river and then drove back and went and saw my uncle do some army stuff.
Oh, boy. Let's not go down that rabbit hole.
Survivalist, is he? What was he doing?
Is that his own private militia?
He was enrolling.
He was the one that was in the news at that stage.
He was enrolling. He did the thing where he joined
Al-Qaeda
the army.
Al-Qaeda or something?
No. No, not also, secret army.
He was also demarking a certain principality, wasn't he? He was seceding from the country at the same time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it Sorry was no big that. Deal. Just army stuff.
And that was Kapuka. But anyway,
right.
So there, Tarago stories. Also, my mate had one, and it was his mum's car, and he used to drive us around in it on his P plates when we were in Cooma back in the day.
Cutting some sick laps, it was such a good car.
We all have this one song that we all remember playing. You know that I've got a new apartment, baby. Oh,
now how does it go? Keep going. I'm not sure of it.
Don't want a karaoke here.
Can't quite place it.
That was the marching cadence that your uncle used when he was parading the troops as well, wasn't it?
He's got a new apartment.
The Tarago thing I remember is when the first one arrived, late 80s. I was working on Motor Magazine. And we realised that its profile was exactly the same as a Fiat Multipla backwards.
Oh, yes.
So we photographed them together. And when you turned Fiat around, it was like the same.
Wow.
Yeah.
So Aero obviously works frontwards and backwards.
Yeah.
Wow. I just remember going on camping trips with, not my family, because we didn't go anywhere.
Your other family.
It was my friend Andrew Gray, his family, the Gray family. And they had a Tarago. And it was like the high-end Tarago, and it had like red velour upholstery.
Yes. With the buttons.
Deluxe.
Did it have buttons?
Yeah.
Button,
everything.
Button
it was
back.
Like, it was button really back well fitted out with a roof, the sunroof.
Yeah. With a roof?
Yeah.
No, the convertible.
Not the convertible Tarago. Oh. That would be amazing.
Wow.
No, with a Targa type. Not
I bet
Targa.
That's been done. I bet there's a bush basher, like paddock basher Tarago
if
somewhere
it, if it
that
hasn't.
Doesn't have a roof.
Yeah. Oh, a Tarago pickup.
I need a Tarago convertible.
Yes.
It would be so rigid and predictable.
It had a stink in it, though. Like, it had a smell.
Was that the Gray family in general?
There were three boys. No, there was a bit of a smell. And it might have been the velour. You can't get smells out of velour.
Well, our last candidate that we've picked as the top five departures is the Mitsubishi Lancer, which was once again been coming from way back when. You know, the sword of Damocles has been hanging over its head forever. And finally, it's departed the scene.
Yeah, I mean...
The Rex's rival. In the Impreza's rival stakes.
The glory days of the Mitsubishi Lancer are a long time ago.
It was an outlier, wasn't it? In the sense that Mitsubishi made it very plain that it wanted to be an SUV and commercial vehicle focused business, and conventional cars, hatches and sedans were going to be tailored. But it's just the Lancer was the last car standing.
Yeah. You know? It was one of Australia's most popular, you know, small cars.
Yeah.
Up there with Corolla.
Popular. That's true.
Because they were selling them for next to nothing.
Nothing.
Yeah.
There's still the Mirage in the Mitsubishi lineup.
Too true. You're right.
For now.
Yes.
Yeah,
That's right.
Which is proudly wearing its dynamic shield grille and looking all the better for it.
Mm-hmm. Aptly named too, the Mirage, because it's probably not going to be there for much longer.
I thought I saw one, but it turned out not to be the case.
It was just suffering from early stage death.
All right, well, they're the five. If there are others that we've missed and you're missing following 2019, let us know. That'd be interesting. Yeah. And what we will do now is move on to our garage and the cars that are very much on sale and available that we have been steering. So, Richard, we'll kick off with you if you don't mind.
Yes, I've been driving the Lexus RX300 Luxury.
Yeah.
So the RX is a large Lexus SUV, but it's not the biggest. It's not the LX, which is the Land Cruiser-based Lexus, giant, big mothership. It's pretty big, though. It's 4.8 metres long. The RX300 has a four-cylinder engine. I've been in the 350 as well. That's got a V6, and you can feel the power difference for sure. Yeah. The four-cylinder makes a whole lot more sense, though, in terms of fuel economy. $71,920. Things I like, I've made three, and things I don't like, 3 points as well. Things I like.
What, about the car or just in general?
Strawberry jam.
I don't like Vegemite without butter on my toast.
Strawberry jam.
Yeah.
Hot showers.
Long walks on the beach.
You don't like, or you do like
I
hot
do like,
showers.
I okay. do like, don't like cold All right, but showers.
Back to the car.
Things I like, you don't have to take the handbrake off when you put it in drive. And you know what?
Yes.
And that gets me in some cars. I mean,
the reverse is true as well, isn't it? Put it in park and the handbrake automatically goes on. Yeah.
Yeah. That's nice. Little things like that. And I knew that and I felt like I was being a bit naughty each time I just put in a drive and accelerate.
Yeah.
I just need to go on. You know what to do. Take the brake off. I like the door pockets. They've got these. The front door pockets have got pockets which sort of pull out. And they're huge. I end up putting everything in there. They're almost like van pockets.
Your entire family.
Whole family would fit in those. Yeah. Also liked comfortable seats, really comfortable. Yeah. As soon as my wife got in, she's like, oh, this is comfortable. Things I don't like, the body control in the RX feels a bit out of control, if you know what I mean. It's the suspension is good, but there's a bit of a wobble.
Yeah.
And that's not just, there's a few other SUVs which have got this issue as well. That back window. So in the images or the video that I shot, which you can see behind me.
If you're watching on YouTube.
If you're watching on YouTube, that's right. That back window, the one that goes, it's not a window. Well, part of it is. The actual window size is about as big as your fist, right? It's big, if you're watching on YouTube, about as big as that, my mug. The rest of the window is not a window. So that cuts down your visibility at the back there. You've got looking through like a tiny hole like that.
Especially if someone in the back seat is just holding up their mug time.
That's right. Exactly right. If someone's drinking in the back and does that, you can't see anything. What else don't I like? The media system.
Ooh.
Please, Lexus, change that.
Give up.
Synaptic.
But it's better now. That one, the new RX has the touchscreen.
I almost went off the road trying to change, my Bluetooth audio. I went just to go from radio to Bluetooth on my phone. Because it moves, and also the USB cord to my phone. When it brushes it, it actually moves the cursor around as well. It's that sensitive.
I had
on the
launch of this car. I did the exact same thing.
You thought it was the cord from your phone. It was actually your mind.
No, seriously. So the cord just doing this, just that, makes the whole cursor go. It changes, can change your settings, everything.
I think it feels like
a point of pride where someone's dug their heels in too hard and should have ages ago said, look, I'll cop it. It's not really working.
We just need to have an amnesty and just no one is going to get blamed for this.
That's a great idea. Let's change it. Yeah, let's have an amnesty.
I think one of the big things about your car that you're in, though, the Lexus base model RX, it's like 10 grand less than the next most expensive RX you can get, right?
So it's 71,920. And when you step up to the 350, it's quite a few more cents.
Jump.
Now, I've got to ask you a what if. Well, what would you do, right? Yep. What would you do? Now, the Audi Q5 is a bit smaller, but you could have an Audi Q5 45 TFSI for $66,900. Mm-hmm. Would you have that, or would you have an RX 300 for $71,900?
Let me think about it, Audi.
Yeah, I'm the same. Not much thought required.
That's right. And see, that's the thing. It's a GLE or an X5, which is, you know, kind of more in the ballpark of size for an RX 300. They're $20,000 more, $30,000 more.
Yeah. All right.
Anyway, that's
what
I've
been in. Thank you very much for that summation.
No, thank
you. Concise and entertaining. Now, M4, we're going to move to you, and it's a long-term vehicle. So it's not just this week that it's been in the garage.
No.
It's been there for some time.
We only collected it recently, though. It's a Honda HR-V RS. Really sporty.
RS. What makes it an RS?
So it gets the biggest wheels you can get in any HR-V. They're 18s, which is very large
That's
for a little
on
car.
An HR-V.
And it also gets a variable steering ratio, so it's more sporty.
Mm-hmm.
And it also gets some unique body styling, like a body kit that runs around all the lower part of the body, including over the wheel arches. There's in black finishes. And it gets different exterior trim finishes on the front and rear as well. It's a nice looking little car, and I'm going to be living with it for 6 months. I've already
not living in it for 6 months. You're going to be living with it.
Well,
although
did I
that
say
could
in
be
it?
An interesting story.
I don't know. Things aren't going so well at home, are they?
Yeah,
I
mean,
you do call it the doghouse.
It does have the magic seat, so you can fold the seat completely flat
with refresh mode. Did you know that there's a mode? If you read the manual, because you know I like to do that.
I know.
There's a refresh mode and involves sitting in the back seat and putting your legs up over the top of the front seat, and this front seat goes down, and it's
how is that described in the owner's manual?
Pretty much just like that.
I'm just getting the schematic that must accompany the text.
Yeah. I demonstrate it. Like years ago, I did a video where I dressed as Batman and did the HR-V review, and I showed people how to use refresh mode. So.
That's odd.
You'll find it there.
That is odd. Yes. Okay, well, that's something to look forward to.
Yeah. I think that's part of the story with the HR-V. You did that video years ago.
Yes.
Right.
And it's still the same car. So it's got some foibles, some issues.
I love the space in the back, though.
Yeah.
The boot, the cargo space is excellent.
And I think it's one of those cars already, I can tell you, it's one of those cars that you buy if you're a smart city buyer, someone who wants a practical but very compact car.
Yeah.
But it's also one of those cars that could be a lot better in a lot of ways.
CVT is annoying. But if you're not about driving and you are about moving people around and you've got lots of, you know, luggage to take, the HR-V is hard to beat.
Yeah. It's smart in lots of ways.
It is.
But yes, well, I'll keep you up to date as I live with it over the next 6 months.
There are a few of those, aren't there, that it must be tempting to just, look, if it isn't broken, don't fix it, you know.
Yep.
We'll leave it in market, it's doing well.
Mm.
But by the time you've milked that for all it's worth, you're really stuffed at the end of it if you haven't got anything to replace it, like ASX, Mitsubishi.
Gosh, I'm glad you said that. Yep, because, definitely.
And I'll be also including, because it's part of our urban guide part of the site, I've installed a dash cam as part of the long-term ownership.
And how does the dash cam work, Matt?
We're not going to go into that.
How easy, because you were telling me yesterday that you need an also...
What brand of dash cam is it, Matt?
Navman?
The one I've got at the moment is a Navman.
Navman.
But I'm going to be doing a comparison test between a bunch of different GoPros, I was going to say, the dash cams, a bunch of them at different price points to see how they all perform.
Are you going to have them all set up on the dash at the same time?
Yes.
Like a comparo.
A comparison.
That's a great idea.
So you can compare the footage between each of them and see what you're getting.
You are going to look like the ultimate stealth cop car.
Massive nerd.
You're going to look like a narc.
You are, totally.
Or the most paranoid driver ever to venture out onto the road.
But surely, like, in this day and age of built-in sat-navs, right, and cameras are coming in, these are superfluous. These are going to be...
Not long for this world.
The counter-argument is that with this sort of system, a dash cam with GPS monitoring, so it can tag if you have an accident and you record it, or it can register if the car's hit when you're not in it. It's also got stuff that these sorts of cars that have been around for a few years and don't have all the latest safety tech, it's got stuff that they miss out on. Like, it's got forward vehicle move away alert. So if you're distracted and the car in front of you moves away, rather than get a honk from the bloke behind you, it goes beep, beep, and then you're, oh, okay, the car in front of me's gone.
You can self-honk.
It's got forward collision warning. It'll detect if you if it thinks you're going to hit the car in front of
That's
you.
That's amazing.
It's got speed limit and speed camera warning zones.
Like, how much these features sound amazing.
How much would people expect to pay for something
like
this?
Well, I'll have to wait and see when I do the comparison test.
That's right.
At Urban
Guide. And if you buy one...
Yeah, how many do I get? Do I get one for my friend as well?
But we can't discount... I know we're being silly.
Get one for the guy
we
in
front.
We can't
discount the fact that these safety features that you can add to your car for $500...
$500?
Is... Less than $500 in some
That
instances.
Sounds too good to be true.
And how do people just call that number at the bottom of the screen now?
This is what I've got to deal with.
How many are left, Richard?
Yeah, look, the stocks are running out,
left?
Aren't they?
You've got to act now.
You know
now,
what?
Is it true?
I'll even throw in a set of steak knives.
No way. And do they cut steak?
No, they're just for road rage purposes.
Now, I'm going to cut through all that. Cut, cut, cut. And tip in
what have you been driving?
A Kia Sorento Black Edition. So it's $48,000. Technically, it's $48,490, but it's current before you pay on-road costs.
Yeah,
it's currently $48,990 drive away. So you're just under $50,000 on the road.
It's a lot of car for the money.
Mm-hmm. It's a 3.5-litre V6 petrol, front-wheel drive only, 8-speed auto, and it's a 7-seater. Yep. So what I would say, the Black Edition is defined largely by gloss black grille, some black alloys, a big sunroof. You've got the black side mirrors, some LED front fog lamps, and a few other bits and pieces. So that's all been added on. And really, the takeouts for me, comfortable, smooth, refined, really good quality inside. I found it hard to fault. Heaps of safety loaded in there. And it made me think, you know, why buy a badge? You know, when I was driving, I was just thinking, this is such a good 7-seater. Mm. You started to just split hairs to find faults with it in the sense that, yeah, it could have more power. Yes, it could be easier to get into the third row. It's a bit awkward. It doesn't have a tumbling kind of second row seat, so you have to clamber into there. But overall, I was really impressed with that car.
Yeah. We've said for a long time that Kia Sorento's, you know, up there.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you'd be... crazy to sort of spend any more money.
Yeah.
And, you know, you can get 7 seats.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which are all accessible, even to adults in the back. It's so good.
And
so
if you really need to use the third row all the time, then we recommend a Carnival because it's the next best thing, but without the SUV body.
Yeah.
But also, can we just say goodbye to Black Editions for now? I'm so sick of them. I reckon there was 20 Black Edition models in 2019.
Because you go from your serious Black Edition, which is Mercedes AMG, which always means like you've got to take the brave pills before you get in whatever it is, to just, some black bits and pieces on a car.
And so many of them are doing it as part of a run-out deal. So we saw a black pack on the Astra, which should have been a ding, 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 ding.
Right.
In mid-2019.
Yes.
But also... That indicates to us that the Sorento is in the end of its life cycle as well.
Right,
That's right.
Good point. They've confirmed that a new one's coming out this year. So
yep. They need to sell what they've got.
Well, if this is the outgoing oldie, it's a good one.
Yeah,
You know, the new one will want to be pretty good.
Mm-hmm. This is the thing. I recently, our sister website, Kelly Blue Book United States, did a study into whether special editions will make you any more money when it comes time to reselling them. Not only did they find out that a special edition car doesn't have the same value as a regular, but you get less for it.
Yeah.
So if you're buying a special edition thinking this is going to be a collector's item in a few years' time, it's better
it's
be
basically your superannuation, isn't it?
Pretty much.
You buy one of these and you're looking, you're sitting on a stack of money in 5 years' time.
That's it. People want to buy the regular car, not, you know, what was the Surf's Up edition of the Hilux from 2019.
I think that's the Sunnyside Up edition.
Particularly like if you're talking about a Nissan X-Trail, N-Trek or something like that, but maybe not so much if you're talking about a performance model that's got a specific launch edition.
Yeah,
But it also goes to, you know, the divisions between grades in a particular model. model of car.
Yeah. Mm.
So you might have a 1.3 engine, a 1.5, and different levels of standard features. That all just melts into one amorphous blob in the second-hand market.
Yeah, it does.
It just becomes a brand X, whatever it is, that model, as opposed to people worried too much about the engines and all that stuff.
Yep.
Like,
yep.
It's good value. This, I mean, look, not taking anything away from the Kia Sorento, it's really good value if you're the first owner and the second owner, but you're not going to get any more for it when you sell it.
Right. Yeah, good point. Mm. All right, well, look, speaking of good cars and some that aren't so good or just cars, it's time for... our favourite car maker in MuskWatch. Now, first up, it's nothing to do with cars. It's all to do with Grimes. So Grimes, the people who know of Grimes, she's a very popular performance artiste in the music business.
Mm.
And she has allegedly been dating the dear leader officially since early 2018. They made a public appearance at the Met Gala in New York.
Mm-hmm.
And so since then, they have been an item, allegedly.
I thought they broke up at some point.
You may have the inside running on that, Richard. I've fallen out of touch with her.
Was that that phone call from Elon
we
a
had
couple
our
of
own
months
issue.
Ago?
Might have been. Yeah, might have been. He calls me drunk at about 2 o'clock his time in the morning.
About Grimes.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Good old Grimesy has posted up a nude pic of herself on Instagram with a photoshopped kind of embryonic baby superimposed over her belly.
Yes.
There is, for those who must, you know, get the full story, there is a full nude version on Twitter, and her handle is at GRIMEZSZ.
I'm just going to go there right now. So
she talks about, in that post, she talks about being knocked up. And everybody has leapt to the conclusion that she is pregnant and that Elon Musk is the father and that they're expecting a child.
There you go.
And Elon, from his previous marriage, already has 5 sons.
Wow.
3 of which I think are triplets.
Wow.
Mm. Will this affect his plans to live on Mars?
Oh.
Maybe he'll just send them all there.
Look, there's plenty of capacity on the Starship. That thing is geared to carry lots and lots of people.
Yeah, it's huge.
He'll have his own one anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, true.
You have
his own planet.
What do you mean, as a dad, will it get in the way of him and his...
You know, if you're planning to jet off in 10 years' time and Elon Jr. is, you know, 10 years old and going, Daddy, I don't want to go.
Oh, I don't think that'll stop him.
Wow.
Mm.
Won't stop him.
Elon Musk the second.
Yeah.
The kids would be the same.
I don't know. Do we know the names of his other kids? Or is that too private?
No, we'll just take that on as a research
project.
Model
1, 2, and 3.
Their names spell out sexy.
That is so wrong.
Sebastian.
Now, speaking of him being a dad, at the Gigafactory opening in China, which in itself is an enormous achievement,
he's
built this enormous, it's for Model 3, Model Y, and some battery production, I think. He was dad dancing with the best of them. So it was the opening. You know, it's the first Tesla Model 3 cars were delivered out of that Shanghai factory. Musk said he'll design a future Tesla vehicle in China that will be sold globally. He also said China would open a new design and engineering center and he'll use the Shanghai Gigafactory to build a production program for the Model Y. All of this really amazing stuff. All anybody's talking about is his exceptionally bad dancing on the stage during the opening ceremony.
I haven't seen dancing like that since a wedding I went to 2 months ago.
And doing the dancing?
It was mainly me. It was me.
So people watching on YouTube, you can catch just a few of his very slick moves happening behind us.
I've never seen something so embarrassing caught
on video. It's pretty bad.
Well, like not since they broke a window of the Cybertruck. That was embarrassing.
That was pretty embarrassing.
Maybe this is all a PR ploy.
He's on
they've
a
said, Elon.
Draw attention away from
can you
it.
Do a dance?
Yeah.
Just to get Cybertruck.
No, they've said, can you do something to get a bit of extra PR? I'm not throwing any metal balls at anything. I'll dance.
And it was bad, and he was wearing a T-shirt, so he had like a button-up shirt.
And he stripped off his coat and did a
semi. And he had a T-shirt over like a long-sleeve button-up shirt, and it looked so... businessman
very
dancing
daggy.
At the office party.
And the translator at the end just going, thank you. No.
And it kept going.
Don't thank him for that.
The only thing that could have improved it would be a bit of pointing.
Oh,
A bit of pointy dancing.
I'm a pointer.
Are you a pointer?
When I get up on, if I go to like a dance hall, I'll jump
you
up.
You do a bit of pointing.
I actually will jump up on the stage and do a bit of pointing.
Where is there a dance
and
hall?
And you.
That's the Elaine Bennis for the Seinfeldians out there.
Dancing.
She's
now,
a bad dancer.
We also now understand why, back in early 2018, he changed his Twitter handle to Elon Tusk.
Yes.
Because it now emerges he's made a cameo appearance in the fourth season of Rick and Morty. And for people who aren't aware of Rick and Morty, it is a fantastic animated series. Now, Rick Sanchez, who's one of the main characters, recruits an alternate Elon Musk from the multiverse, who is actually Elon Tusk.
Yeah.
Surnamed because he has tusks emerging from his lower jaw. And it's a complicated heist scenario, including Steely, which is one of my favourite characters, I must say, from Rick and Morty. And Tusk says his tusks keep his ego in check and he'd be a more difficult character without them. So,
and it's actually voiced by Elon Musk. It's great.
He's done it himself.
It's so good.
Yeah.
You know what? You know, I have this meter in my head where I love him and then I hate him. And then I went back to love again after he did that.
That's good.
Yeah.
Well, bear in mind, it was a year ago.
There you go.
So in the interim, you've gone up and down.
It's back up again.
Anyway, now speaking of back up again, the share price is now at $481, a bit over $481. And the last time we met, which was a few weeks ago in the end of last year, $404 when we signed off.
So it's gone up
another $80.
How's that possible? That's the price of it. How much is Telstra or a regular share
these days? Jeff Reeves at MarketWatch says he has five things that Tesla bears keep getting wrong
about
this stock.
Like bears?
So they're
like
bear negative. They're not very negative bears about the stock. Oh, well. The whole thing with bears and Jeff Reeves doesn't we don't want to go into that. But
not that kind of bears.
He says that hyped up themes or stocks tend to be driven by a narrative, not fundamentals, and a perfect fodder for speculation. Sounds logical. But eventually hard facts or simple impatience takes its toll and the high-flying stocks fall out of favour. But what he's saying is there are five reasons why you shouldn't think that way about Tesla as a stock. First one, look, it's gone more than 2,500% growth since its 2010 initial public offering. That is hard to argue with.
Yep.
He says Tesla's China opportunity isn't overblown. Musk's five-year-old forecast is right on schedule. Old share price targets are just that, old. So it's a fast-moving, it's a volatile stock and it's a fast-moving sector. Market capitalization is irrelevant, so people trying to compare Tesla with GM and Ford and all these very large companies, he considers that irrelevant. And shorting is for suckers. You know, a bearish position on Tesla is simply a money-losing proposition, is what he says, evidenced by the growth since 2010 in the value of the share.
Isn't it funny, though, that, you know, just 3 months ago we were talking about this is the end.
I know.
Yeah.
They're done.
The number of predictions, you know, we were on that bandwagon. Yep. This is looking bad, very shaky. Yeah.
This China deal, I reckon, will cement it because, as everybody knows, when you go into business in China, you go into business with the Chinese government.
And at the risk of stating the bleeding obvious, the big critical issue there is China's adoption and continued love affair with electric cars.
That's right.
Whether that continues to be the case.
I reckon it could. This will seal it.
When you're an all-electric car company, you do have your eggs in one basket.
Oh, yeah.
So if China, for whatever reason, falls out of love with electric cars, you either want to diversify and change your position pretty quickly, or you're going
to
suffer.
Well, they did start to fall out of love with them late last year when they started to roll back the incentives. The sales of electric cars plummeted by about 20%.
Yeah.
So I don't know whether it's going to be the be-all and end-all for them, but
as always, we get to watch from the sidelines.
Yeah.
Yes. And with that, we have reached the finish line. Thank you, Richard.
Thank you.
And thank you, Matt.
Thank you.
And thanks, as always, to our executive producer and lead sound architect, Mr. Pritchard, for his zen-like calm and stunning skills. He's gone full art house today with the blue man face, he's got the denim vest, and the Argyle golf pants, which it's an absolutely striking combination.
Look.
Oh, it is a look.
He feels the trouser well.
Please pass on the word about the podcast and let us know your thoughts by searching for CarsGuide on Facebook and Instagram using the hashtag CGPodcast or email us at comments@carsguide.com.au. If you're an iTunes listener, please rate and review us. And remember, you can watch us on YouTube. But before we go, a mate of mine's living in Minnesota at the moment.
Oh, in America.
It was minus 10 overnight and he told me he couldn't find the car window scraper.
So he had to use a plastic store discount card to clean the icy windows on his car.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't work very well. He only got 20% off.
Uh-huh.
What store was it from?
He didn't mention it.
Oh.
May have been Tarjay.
Yeah, could have been JB Hi-Fi.
They don't have JB.
Napman?
Sadly, they don't have it in Minnesota.
Yeah. Is that it? That's the end of the podcast, isn't it?
Bye.
Bye.